memberships and you have got a target, you put a target, and I'm very thankful that you're including us, and this definitely is going to be very helpful to the students. As of now, I'm sure none of the students know how this is going to be useful to them, but it will be for us, the V.H. Patil sir and his team, to get this, understand this, and then give it to the students how they can be of use to you also after we invite it. When it comes to when sir rang me up yesterday, he talked about materials. Materials, metallurgy, and these words, I hear these words, it strikes an emotional chord within me. My father was also an engineer, and he was a metallurgical engineer. In 1952-53, he was at PHU. We were not there, all of us were not there that day. At that time, he was not there, or it's a different company, the BSc in fuel for technology and materials, I think something like that. Then he went to Germany, he did PhD, and materials which are flexible and tempering with the heat, how you they change, all these things he did, and then he learned them then. Since one of his projects also. Then he was a very, he was a scientist by nature, my father. And he used to think of, he was very interested in all innovative things. But then because of constraints of family and background, he could not pursue that and he had to go into a job. But when he came with metallurgy PhD to India, back to India, there was no job opportunities at that time. And he had joined a firm called Mecon, which is Metallurgical Engineering Consultants. Yeah, Rathi. And then he did his retirement to that firm. And they did a lot of work everywhere. At that time, only with mining and this thing, steel plants. Now they are working, their firm is working with NASA for the project, their projects and all. It's a very big field. It's a very sad thing. We don't have metallurgical engineering in this area as a degree for people. But now we come to materials. So science graduates can also be motivated. As you said, in schools, you're targeting now school children so that they get motivated and they opt for these subjects when they go into college. It's a very good idea, and I definitely even we shall as we try to adopt this and get our school children to get interested. Like I was just thinking we can get all these materials which you say, like metals and some experiments related to that. We can have projects in school so that children find that, understand that such an interesting field, and they get inclined to take it up further when they go to college. I'm sure the students have understood what the gist of today's gathering is, and definitely we'll make sure on this that our students also get motivated and they enthusiastically join all your activities. Thank you again for coming here.
Sir is also serving as transfer committee member of AICT. Sir guided more than 10 PhD students. Out of them, four get opportunity at abroad in Germany, France, Spain, Korea. He is awarded as a young scientist outstanding work presentation award by Material Research Society, Japan in 2005. Sir is nominated for Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award in 2018 by Director VNIT Nagpur. Sir has completed 9 major research projects with worth rupees 2.12 crore. It gives me immense pleasure to invite our today's chief guest, Dr. V.R. Sandhuhar sir, to deliver his expert talk on topic material mutualism, energy conversion and storage application. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon to all of you. I am very much thankful Dr. Ullas Patil sir, founder Godavari Foundation, Dr. Mrs. Patil, chairman Godavari Foundation, Dr. V.H. Patil sir, principal of this college, Mr. Bonde, chairman ASM International, Dr. Singhal, ASM International, Dr. Kohli sir, HOD Mechanical, and Mr. Vandari sir, who has taken care from the morning 6 o'clock for me. I wish to thank you and thank you for inviting me to give you this lecture which is related to the material. And my friends are there, Dr. Rane from Simeon, Dr. Vagode, principal, GNCBUTS and faculties of this college and my dear friends. So here I wish to give some emphasis regarding the material. I think maybe you have been the background, maybe computer, maybe mechanical, maybe electrical and electron science. Right, but I think you don't have material science. But don't worry about that one. I am physics, belong to the physics, but I am doing materials, I am doing chemistry. Right? So without integration and multidisciplinary approach, it is very difficult to work with some application part. So here I will give some emphasis that how the material can be developed by using simple, just as I told that, everything it is needed with a lower cost. So we thought to use this material, to synthesize this material by using simple, low cost chemical method. Not only just synthesize and leave it, but we have to characterize that materials. Not only that one, we have applied that materials for very hot topic called energy conversion and storage, which is a presently hot topic and every society needs that one. Because as you have seen that, for example, if you are using the car, right, your battery can withhold, for example, 3 to 4 years. Suppose something is coming out which can maybe withstand for lifespan of suppose 10 years or 15 years, it can change your whole scenario. Or you can think about the solar cell, that is called as a photovoltaics, so which can take the light which is freely available, which can convert to the electricity, right? And if efficiency in terms of the solar cell, it is going to change, and you can maybe, you are the person, maybe alter that efficiency so that it can enhance about suppose 20% or 30% with a lower cost, I am saying. Then it is a great challenge, it is there, and great achievement it will be there. So here I used to give emphasis how you can think and your idea can be explored by using suppose certain low cost technology may be there, you can develop some computer person may be there, they can do the simulation, some mechanical person they can think about the whatever the mechanical thing it may be there, you can think about the flexibility of the solar cell, you can maybe think about whatever the application part it is there, device it is there, you can think about the flexibility concern or mechanical properties are concerned. So you can certainly devote for this technology. So here you can get little bit just idea how to develop the materials and not to develop but to apply the material. So here I am saying about the material mutualism. Do you know what it means of mutualism? Mutualism is not only in the case of interdisciplinary courses are there, we have to do the material mutualism concept may be there. We can take advantage of the each course and then you can utilize for the final product so that it can be applicable for the society. So, but here I am used to talk about the material mutualism in terms of the energy conversion and the storage application. So I belongs to VNIT. Previously I worked in North Maharashtra University, Jalgaon for 4.5 years. Before that I worked in Germany for 3 years, Japan for 2 years, and then US, and then I joined North Maharashtra. When I got opportunity in VNIT, I moved to VNIT in 2012. So basically, how the material should be? You should think about which can help the material to clean the past environmental damage, correct the present environmental impact problems, prevent future environmental impact, which can help to sustain the planet for the future generation. So benefits for the today and tomorrow, lot of things are there when you are thinking about the material. As Patil sir has engineering college, this medical college is there, and you are from the engineering background, and you can have the mutualism between the both, so that you can think about how the mutualism can come out for the, it can be applicable for the society as well. So it can be for medicine and health, as you have seen that in the corona cases, maybe you can have certain simulation problem, you can work on the simulation for the bacteria or whatever the thing, virus it is there, and then you can animate that one so that you can predict about the certain things. Then in the medical field also you can think about the dread tumors, which can have specific drug delivery against the cancer cells. You can have information technology, I think Dr. Sunit Rane sir, he will talk about that one, about the electronic application. Then energy production and storage, just I am going to talk about this one, in terms of the solar cell and super capacitor, it can be maybe hydrogen fuel cells. Then material science, maybe you can think about lightweight and maybe having flexible, maybe strong, it is there. Then food, water and environment may be there. Then instrumentation, maybe you can think about a different microscopy, it can be concerned. But whenever you are thinking about the material, if you are thinking to use this material in the nano form, then it can have a wide applicability. So nano means what? It is a Greek word called dwarf. That is the manipulation of the matter having the size less than 100 nanometer. And if your size is approximately less than 10 nanometer, then you can see these are the quantum dots. So this plays very important role for the different device grade application, because it can change its property, it can alter its property depending upon the size. So basically nanotechnology, it is a creation useful functional materials, device and system of any size, but whatever it contains, it may be the nano material, so that it can change the physical, chemical, electrical, mechanical, magnetic or optical property is there. Just as one example, you are, I think most of the ladies as well, they are wearing the rings which is made up of the gold. Gold, it is yellow in color. So I do not want to alter the gold. Gold it is same, but I want to change the property. Instead of looking the yellow, if it is looking like red or maybe blue, then it is drastic change, it is there. Right? That can be done by choosing the size of the particle which is embedded inside that ring. So if you are changing the size of the particle, maybe in the nano size or maybe in the quantum dots, you can alter the properties of the material without changing the material. That is the advantage of this nanotechnology or nanomaterials. So here I will give the emphasis how to synthesize the nanomaterial by using simple low cost chemical method, which can be applicable just in this case, so that you can have a little bit look regarding the energy conversion and storage. So for example, if you are thinking about the gold, the melting point of the gold, it is above 1000 degrees Celsius. But if you are changing the size and its radius, it is less than 3 nanometer, for example, you can see that the melting point can change drastically. So that is the beauty of this nanotechnology. So you can play with this nanomaterial as well. So just one example, if you think about the water at the macro scale, it is a lubricant. But if you are thinking about the nano scale, it is an adhesive. That is the property. And this is another example, it is there, that is a cadmium selenide. It is a semiconducting material having the size about 1.7 electron volt. If you are changing the size of the particle, for example 2 nanometer to 8 nanometer, the color can be changed. So this is the beauty of the nanomaterial. Just by changing the size of the particle, you can change the different properties without changing the material. That is the advantage. So you can ask yourself whether it is so complicated with the work with this nano. So maybe you are thinking that it is very difficult to synthesize the material in the nano form, right? But at the end of this lecture, you will get certain answer whether it is so difficult or not difficult. Because everybody is facing the problem of the finance, that you should have certain instrument, you should have certain clean room to synthesize the nanomaterials, but it is not. So usually I am giving this giving this idea that from the Three Idiots movie, right? What is that? That is, choose excellence, success will follow you, right? And you can use in your course as well. If you are choosing the excellence, success will follow you. And just I have modified this title as chase quantum nano will follow you. Means you can think to synthesize the nanomaterial automatically, synthesize the quantum material automatically, you can get the nanomaterial. Then you can think, try to do simple things by using simple way. Learn more, used to apply more complicated things by a simple way, so that it can be applicable for the society. So most important part, whatever research it is there, whatever you are concerning, whatever the materials it is there, it should be applicable for the society. And this ASM Material International, they are doing a good job that whatever material it is there, it is applicable for the society. So energy conversion and utilization, it is there. When you are thinking about the electricity, that we can get abundant source of energy from the sun, then we can use that one for the energy conversion by means of the photovoltaics. Then I am going to talk about one concern, that is called as the Dyson Sitter solar cell, and then one concern about the energy storage, how to store that energy by means of super capacitor. So there are two things are there which is included in my talk. So here it is based on the nanomaterial for the solar cell and super capacitor application. So whenever you are doing the things, you should synthesize, you should characterize the material, you should apply the material at the end. So what you need the basic background about the chemistry, physics. If both are going in hand, then it is having great help. But this is not enough. You should have the engineering as well as the technology, because it should be applicable for the society, so that at the end, you should have the device in your hand. So whenever you are thinking about any device grade application, there are three things or three steps are there. One is the material, second one is the process, and third one is the properties. So material concern, it is there. You can think about the nanoparticle, nanowire, quantum dot, nanotube, it is there. Then process, you should think about the low cost process, because whenever you are developing certain process, that should be industrialized at the end, so that you can think to develop the material at the larger scale, so that it can be applicable to the society with a lower cost. And whatever the raw material you are using, that should be with a lower cost. Because suppose I want to synthesize the silicon solar cell, fabrication of the silicon, it is very, very difficult. As you know that silicon oxide, it is abundantly available, but you cannot make the silicon from that one, because you need clean room technology for that one to synthesize the silicon at the very great beauty. So you can alter the property, just I told about the thermal property, electrical, mechanical, optical or magnetic property, whenever you are thinking about any device grade application. So just I am concerning about the energy conversion, so that you can get little bit idea how to think about the research, maybe from your core side, and then you can apply for those societies. Here just concern about the solar cell. So we have unlimited source of energy, we can utilize freely, so that we can use this one to take that energy and to convert into the electricity by means of photovoltaics. So as you know that this type of solar cell you have seen, silicon, maybe gallium arsenide it is there, or maybe CIGCs, these are little bit costly solar cells. So we thought to use the development of the material for the solar cell application in case of dye-sensitized solar cell. So before going into the wording called dye-sensitized solar cell, basically you can have the idea about the basic background. So your basics should be very clear as you are, whatever you are learning, your basics should be very clear that can be applicable for the society. So how this solar cell works? Up till now you have studied the p-n junction type of solar cell in the 12th standard, and maybe you can think maybe this is the first time you have learned this one in this way, that you can have a p-type silicon and n-type silicon, and it can be sandwiched metrologically. So this is on the basis of energy band diagram. So whenever you have p-type silicon, n-type silicons and joined metrologically, there is a formation of the depletion region, or we can say it is a space charge region. So when you can illuminate with the visible light for this one, there is a generation of the electron hole pair, and this electron hole pair gets separated because of the built-in field, and this electron travel through the external circuit. Maybe you can think about the load where you can have a battery where that charges can be stored, and this cycle it is completed and electricity it is generated. And this is the simple way how to understand this solar cell. Then our approach is to make the colorful cell also. Maybe this may be the new word for you, it is a colorful, because you have seen the silicon maybe blue in color, but you have not seen the solar cell maybe red in color or yellow in color or orange in color, right? So I will say the advantage of this one at the end. So it is based on the dye-sensitized solar cell with a low cost, low temperature process, chemically deposited zinc oxide, which can have attractive application along with shortcut in production cost. And whatever the process we have used, that is environmentally benign. So it is colorful, see-through, flexible, cheap and lightweight maybe. So how this dye-sensitized solar cell works? Here you can have, this is the basic cross-section image, you can say, or block diagram for this type of solar cell. This is a TCO, called as a transparent conducting oxide. That is, you can use FTO or ITO, which can be coated on the glass, which can be transparent, on which you can coat the nano material called titanium dioxide, which is having high surface area. So basic requirement for the dye-sensitized solar cell, it should have the high surface area, interconnection of the nanoparticles should be there, and wide band gap should be there, on which you can pour the dye, that is a one monolayer of the dye, it is there. So there is a material mutualism between this TiO2 nanoparticle and the dye, so that you can have a very high surface area absorption part, it is there for the visible light. Then you can place the liquid electrolyte, and this is the back contact. And this is on the basis of energy band diagram, conduction band, valence band of this TiO2, dye and electrolyte. When you illuminate this type of solar cell with the visible light, electron gets excited within the dye, it can transfer to the conduction band of the TiO2. And this electron, it is transported through the external circuit to this electrolyte. And this cycle, it is completed and electricity, it is generated. And simple way, here we can see, if you are illuminating with the light, you can see this electron transferred to the TiO2. Which is generated through the dye molecule, and it will reach to the electrolyte, and the cycle completion gives the electricity. As this higher energy conversion it is there, it was achieved in 1991 by Professor Michael Crutchen, and it was 11%. It was not reached about 13% till now. So there is a need that you should search about the other materials, you can play with the other material, so that the efficiency can be improved at the lower cost, because this type of solar cells are there, which is much cheaper than silicon type of solar cells. So this is the laboratory scale development, it is there, we made in the laboratory. Here you can see that this is glass, this is transparent conducting oxide, this is a blocking layer of the zinc oxide, this is the nanoporous zinc oxide, here red color dye it is there, electrolyte it is there, and back contact. And this is the step wise development it is there. We can have the zinc oxide, that layer, nanoporous zinc oxide, because for the dye-sensitized solar cell, you need very high surface area, and you have zinc oxide with a nanoporous morphology, and then we are using the liquid electrolyte. So this liquid electrolyte can easily penetrate through this zinc oxide, which can turn to this TCO, so that the whole device can be shortened. And to avoid this one, we have used this one as a blocking layer. And then sensitize the dye, which is the one monolayer liquid electrolyte, and then back contact, finally we have tested this one under the standard condition. So we have used a simple spray pyrolysis technique to make the FTO, that is chlorine dopantin oxide glass substrate. And here you can see that this is glass, this is FTO coated, glass substrate and transparency, it is 93, above 93%, and this is the thickness, about 500 nanometer it is there, having the seed resistance about 15 ohm per square. At present, you can get lot of FTO, means about, for example, 4 or 5,000, you can get 1 feet by 1 feet FTO, which is very easily available. So then we have used the zinc oxide, which is chemically deposited by using two techniques. One is called as a chemical bar deposition, and second one is the SILAR, called a successive ionic layer adsorption and reaction method. Then we have utilized this both method. So SILAR means what? It is a cationic and anionic adsorption and reaction it is there. So for zinc oxide, we have used zinc acetate with ammonia as a cationic source. And then we have used simply water at higher temperature, that is 80 to 90 degrees Celsius as anionic precursor. Then we have dipped the FTO inside this one. And this you can see that this is simply beaker system it is there. So that this is a very low cost technology it is there. So that we can work on this one, so that you can develop the solar cell in the laboratory using low cost methods. So after dipping this one, there is the adsorption of the zinc ions. Then this water at a higher temperature which contains OH ions. So zinc ions gets reacted with the OH ions so that you can get zinc hydroxide and zinc oxide on the substrate. And then you can heat that one at 200 degrees Celsius for 1 hour so that you can get pure zinc oxide. Usually TiO2 it is used for the disensitized solar cell application, which is heated at 450 degrees Celsius. But we have done this one at 200 degrees Celsius. Our target it was to do this one at 100 degrees Celsius so that you can use plastic substrate so that solar cell can be possible to bend, so that you can make a flexible solar cell. Then we have characterized that one so that you can get the exact idea about whatever the material it is developed. We got the hexagonal zinc oxide. Here you can see this is the 1 micrometer scale bar it is there, and here it, and under this 1 micrometer you can see that specific orientation of the zinc oxide, which is oriented perpendicular to the C axis, and we have used this one as a flat or ciliate zinc oxide on which we have grown the nanoporous zinc oxide, because for biosensitized solar cell you should have interconnection of the nanoparticle with high surface area. So what we have done, we have used simple chemical bar deposition, and we have used zinc acetate with hexamethyl tetraamine and the deposition temperature just room temperature, and using beaker system. We have grown that one for example 20 to 40 hours, and then it was annealed at 200 degrees Celsius. And this is the image of the zinc oxide, which is white in color. So white in color means what? Whatever the visible part it is there, it can pass through this zinc oxide so that it can fall on the dye molecule so that electron hole pair can be generated. So again we have characterized this one with the structural pattern called XRD studies, so that we observed hexagonal crystal structure. The most important part is the optical band gap. So that band gap it is greater than 3 electron volt means what? Whatever visible part it is there, it can pass through the zinc oxide. And we have observed the band gap it is about 3.3 electron volt. So that whatever visible light it can pass through the zinc oxide, which can fall on the dye molecule. But the most important part, whether it is high surface area zinc oxide or not. So here you can see this is the petal-like morphology of the zinc oxide with the scale bar 2 micrometer. But interconnection of the nanoparticle with high surface area it is required. So we have just taken the high magnification image, and here you can see the scale bar which is 100 nanometer, and you can see interconnection of the nanoparticle, and this leads to the very high surface area. And these are the nanoparticles of the zinc oxide which can be coated on FTO, which can be used for the dye-sensitized solar cell application. So on this is the cross-sectional image, and here you can see hydrophilic surface. This was all result, it was published inside this journal. You can get all the data inside this one. So here on this zinc oxide, we have adsorbed the dye molecule just by dipping the zinc oxide in ethanolic solution of the dye, where dye it is chemically adsorbed on this zinc oxide, that is one monolayer of the dye. Then we have completed this one as the device, as we have penetrated this one with a liquid electrolyte, and platinum it is back contact, and we have used polyiodide as a liquid electrolyte for this type of solar cell. So this is the completion of the device. And here initially we have used eosin wire as a dye. For example, for this 1 gram of the dye, you can get about 500 or 600 rupees. Bottle it is there, and you can use the micromolar solution, very less quantity of the dye it is there, which is possible to use. But the disadvantage of this dye it is there, you can see the absorption it is between 500 to 550 nanometer. It's very low absorption it is there within the visible part of the solar spectrum. But the beauty is that when you are absorbing this dye on the zinc oxide, you can see red in color. So that is the beauty, so that you can fabricate the solar cell which is red in color. So after making the device. Here you can see, this is the product which is there. This is the FDO coated zinc oxide on dye, it is there, and you can see red color it is there, back contact it is there, and liquid it is penetrated between this one in the by using capillary action, and we have fabricated the device having 1 cm². We have optimized different parameter and we have reached the efficiency above 2%. Because if you compare this one with the silicon type of solar cell or gallium arsenide type of solar cell, the cost issue, it is 1000 times less than that of the solar cell. So that is the beauty, where area is not restricted, you can use this type of solar cell, although efficiency it is less. Not only this one, this is also published inside the Solar Energy Journal. So not only this one, we have used D149 dye, because whenever you are using zinc oxide, you need carboxylic group. So you need the dye with the carboxylic group, so that there is a very well attachment of the dye molecules with the zinc oxide. So we have used D149 dye, which is having more absorption in the visible part, and the efficiency it is reached to 3.5%. But advantage is that this is a brown in color. So not only this dye, this is also published inside the Material Journal. So not only this one, we have done certain color code approach, so that whatever the color eosin Y, it gives the red color. We have used coumarin dye, which is a yellow color, which is adsorbed on the zinc oxide. Then also we have used methylene blue dye, which is a blue color. But disadvantage of this methylene blue dye, it is not having the carboxylic group, but it is having chromium group, which is not well attached with the zinc oxide. But this coumarin and eosin Y, which is very well attached on the zinc oxide, this is absorption against the wavelength. You can see yellow color, red color and blue color. And this is the eosin Y adsorbed zinc oxide. Then you can have the yellow color on the zinc oxide and blue color on the zinc oxide. And we have calculated this one under the standard conditions, and it shows the efficiency above 1%. This is about 2%, but because not having the carboxylic group, efficiency it is very less, it is 0.02%. But we have used these three dyes that make the advanced color code approach. So we have red color, we have yellow color, we have blue color in our hand. And as you can see that, if you have having red, yellow and blue, if you mix red color with the yellow color, you can get the orange color. If you mix the red color and blue color, you can get the violet color. And if you are mixing the red, blue with the yellow color, you can get the green color. Means if you have three basic color in your hand, it is possible to develop different colors, so that you can make very colorful solar cells. And we have done just by mixing red color with the yellow color to get the orange color, and this is the orange color dye, it is there, which is adsorbed on the zinc oxide, so that we can get the orange color. And this is absorption versus wavelength. You can see this is for yellow color, this is for red color, and by combination it covers the both the part, and you can get the orange color in your hand. So you can have the orange color type of solar cell. So this is quantum efficiency, this is incident photon current conversion efficiency against the wavelength, and this is for completed device. And here you can see orange color covers the both the part. And advantage is that the efficiency it is enhanced, not only enhanced, but you are getting orange color in your hand. That is the basic advantage. Means you can have another color, that is the for the solar cell. Not only this one, we have done a different type of the dyes, which is adsorbed on the zinc oxide. This is, you can see eosin Y, rhodamine B, rose bengal, coumarin, mercury chrome, D149, N719, methylene blue. Each absorption gives its own efficiency, that is because of the intrinsic property, and you can see different color can give the different color as well as different efficiency. So that it is possible that whatever color you want, for example if you want red color or if you want orange color, then you can make the solar cell, this type of solar cell, so that you can have dual application. What type of application it is there? This was also published as a basic idea advanced approach. Here, what application it is there? I will tell you after this achievement. This is a digital watch, it is there. Simply, there is no perfect sealing, although liquid it is there. And here you can see that there is a connection of the three cells in series, because for running the digital device, we require 5 volt. This solar cell, it gives 0.5 volt. We have connected in series, it is 1.5 volt. This is a calculator, and these both are running by using lab-made device. And these are fabricated by using simple solution chemistry, simple using by using beakers and raw materials as a simple chemicals, which are cheaper one. Here you can see that this is actually working of the device. This is dark and light. There is no perfect sealing, still it works about 1 month. That is the beauty of this one. And if you have perfect sealing, then it can work maybe more than 5 years. So here you can see this, whenever you are fabricating the material, whenever you have certain application, then you can get the satisfaction in your mind. Although paper protection, it is another part. So what the advantage it is there? For example, if your roof tile by using brown color or maybe umbrella having red color, whatever color that you want, you can replace with this type of solar cell. Advantage is that it is used for light to electricity conversion, one thing, and second one, it is for the attractiveness. So dual purpose application it is there for this type of solar cell, which is very beautiful, because for example roof tile, lot of area it is there, although efficiency may be lower, but where you can replace this type of solar cell, which is called as a colorful solar cell, by using low cost solution chemistry. Then second approach, it is there that the super capacitor, everybody heard about the battery and the capacitor. Capacitor means what? It can charge very quickly, it can recharge very quickly. And battery means what? It requires little bit more time to charge, and it also it delivers the whatever energy stored it is there for longer time. But the disadvantage of the battery is there, it can run up to 3 to 4 years. So it can have specific life span, depending upon specific cycles, how many times you are charging and discharging. Another disadvantage is that we are using liquid, which is the acid. So it is a toxic concern it is there. So new things it is coming out, which is intermediate between the capacitor and the battery. So that it is a midway between the capacitor and battery, we can think about, which is called as a super capacitor. So it is not simply capacitor, it is called as a super capacitor, used to store the energy. It's whatever energy it is there that is being stored by means of this super capacitor. So it represents the new generation of the electrochemical energy storage device, which is having high energy density than the batteries and high power density than the capacitor. So whenever you are thinking to replace the battery, you should have the device with high energy density. So you can think, and whenever you are thinking to replace the capacitor, you should have the high power density. So either you can work on the high energy density or high power density. So that is the thing. Means what is the energy? Energy, it is the capacitor to do the work. And power, how fast the energy it is delivered. That is the most important thing. But present, most of the researchers, they are working and focusing to improve the energy density so that batteries it is possible to replace or not. So here this is called as a Reagan plot, which can give the specific power, watt per kg, and specific energy. And here you can see this is fuel cell, battery, and capacitor it is there. Capacitor it is having more specific power, battery it is having more specific energy, and this is the intermediate between the capacitor and the battery. Means whenever you require very high power, you are going for the capacitor, and you require very high energy, then you are going for the battery. But this it is intermediate between the capacitor and the battery it is there. How it is intermediate? You can think about the different parameters. Those who are maybe belongs to the electrical or electronics, they can understand very easily this one. So charging time it is there. For capacitor, it can charge within millisecond to microsecond. But for the battery, it requires certain minutes to certain hours. But if you are thinking about the super capacitor, it can charge within 1 minute. That is the beauty. And the similar thing for the discharge, it is discharge within 1 minute. So basically energy density also it lies between the battery and the capacitor and the power density. Most important thing whenever you are working to replace the battery, the advantage being the super capacitor, it is having higher cycle life, that is about 10,000 to 1 lakh or more than that it is there. So efficiency it is there close to 1% for the super capacitor, and this is the available market, available battery it is there, this is the capacitor it is there, and this is the boost cap super capacitor it is there. But these companies, they are using liquid inside this one. So our aim we made to fabricate the super capacitor, which is completely solid state. Not only this one, if it is flexible, you can bend that one. That is the beauty of this one. So what affection it is there? Lot of affection it is there, whether your device it is bendable. Because previously you have seen the TV which are very big, now flat TVs are available. Maybe in the future you can see flexible TVs. Right? That may be the new technology comes up, and then you can have advantage of the material, then you can apply that one. So this is one example, supercapacitor in China, they are using prototype Shanghai, they are using supercapacitor, which they have used to run the bus. But this is based on the liquid cell. So what the advantage is that it requires lower charging time. Means whenever the people are riding in the bus at one station, it gets charged. then it can run about 10 to 15 kilometers. During that one, it can again discharge. Again, when people are riding in the another station, it gets charged. So people are and researchers are thinking to replace the battery by having higher energy density. Suppose if you are getting energy density equal to battery, then that bus can run maybe 60 kilometer, 100 kilometer, or more than that. It is possible maybe in the future. So they are thinking to replace this type of battery in case of running this vehicle as well. Not only this one, these are the advanced applications are there. For example, flexible things, whatever the flexible thing it is there, it is possible to replace. So we thought to use the MEG super capacitor, which are flexible one. So in the wearable devices also, in the for example clothes also, you can have the device. For example, here you can see that it is for the wearable device, it is there, the wearable clothes are there. You can have certain cotton clothes, it is there, where you can have light wool, where it can be coated with a certain material, so that you can wear that type of storage devices. So supercapacitor, it is having two types, just to understand this one basic things. You can have two types, one is called as the EDLC and second one is called as the pseudo. So EDLC means what? Where storage mechanism involves, there is a charge separation at the electrode and electrolyte interface, and most of the carbon based material, maybe you heard about the carbon nanotube, carbon aerogel, right? That material are being used inside this EDLC type of material. And the pseudo means what? Where there is a catalytic reaction, like metal oxides, polymers are there, these are used inside this case of pseudo capacitor. So inside the EDLC type of super capacitor, this is process low capacitor, that is the disadvantage. But it is having very high stability, that is the advantage. But if you are thinking about the pseudo capacitor, it is having high capacitance but less stability. So you can have the material mutualism between these two, called EDLC and pseudo, if you combine this one, so that you can get the high capacitance as well as high stability. So we have done this one in the laboratory so that we can get flexible supercapacitor in your hand. So we are mixing this one with the pseudo and electrical double layer so that we can have a hybrid capacitor. As this EDLC, it is maybe carbon nanotube, graphene, carbon aerogel, activated carbon, and we have used carbon nanotube, which is commercially available. So to improve the energy density, you should work on this one to have the higher increase in the capacitance, like specific surface area, porous size, electrical conductivity, redox reaction, it is there. Or if you are thinking about increasing the voltage, you can think about organic electrolyte or ionic electrolyte or combination of the symmetric or asymmetric type of the supercapacitor. So advantage being CNT we have used, which is having high stability as well as high conductivity, but it is having low capacitance. And polymer metal oxides we have used, which is having high capacitance but less stability. But material mutualism is what? If you are having composite, it can have improved electronic conductivity with well directed conducting path, which can have a dual charge storage mechanism, because there are certain requirements for the supercapacitor, that it should have the high conductivity, large surface area, good chemical stability and good reversibility. So what we have done in the laboratory, we have the conducting substrate like stainless steel, which is easily available in the market. It is having certain grade, 306 grade it is there, 0.02 mm it is there, so that it is flexible. So we have coated with the different material like nanoplex, nanoparticle, nanowires, pore shell type of nanostructure. Then we have coated with the carbon nanotube, which is commercially available. Then this is carbon nanotube, it is belongs to the EDLC. We have coated again with this type of material called nanoplex, nanoparticle, quantum dots it is there, or polymer it is there for this type of application. So what we have done, this is just to have an idea, just I will give one example as vanadium oxide, which is coated on the carbon nanotube, which is multi-wire carbon nanotube, in thin film form as a material mutualism concept to fabricate the flexible supercapacitor. So what a requirement for the supercapacitor, whenever you are using pseudo, you should have a higher oxidation state. So vanadium, it belongs to the higher oxidation state, and carbon nanotube, it is having one dimensional, which is having higher conducting path, it is there, we have used inside this one. So simply deep and dry coating technique we have used for the carbon nanotube. So we have used the stainless steel, we have dipped inside the solute plus solvent, which is belongs to the carbon nanotube, and then we have dried that one, and so that carbon nanotube coated on the stainless steel substrate. Simply deep dry technique, nothing else, so that it is a low cost technology. So this is carbon nanotube, which is just dipped inside this one. So here you can see that Then we have dried under the air lamp, and here you can see this is the carbon nanotubes are there, and you can see the diameter, it is less than 100 nanometer, but length is not restricted. So these are the carbon nanotube coated on the stainless steel substrate. We have used this one as an EDNC type of material on which we have coated vanadium oxide on this one, which is having pseudo type of material, so that we can have material mutualism. So not only on stainless steel, we have coated on FTO, PET, glass and PVC. So it can have a wide application. Very uniform coating it is there of this carbon nanotube on this type of substrate. But you have to optimize that one, because for everything, whatever you are doing, optimization it is required. For example, if you are making chapati, also optimization it is required. How much water it is there, how much weight it is there. Similar thing it is there in this processing. So vanadium oxide, we have used simple chemical baths. We have used vanadium source solution and then NMOS solution inside this one. And here you can see that this is a carbon nanotube. This is vanadium oxide coated on the stainless steel. And this is a vanadium oxide whenever coating on the carbon nanotube. Here inside you can see these are the carbon nanotube. And this flakes like morphology it is there, which is a vanadium oxide. For supercapacitor, you should have very high surface area. So that can be utilized, because whenever high surface area is there, your device performance can be extended to a larger extent. So this is TM image, so that you can see this is a carbon nanotube and this is the things are there, which is vanadium oxide. So here you can see EDX mapping, it is there during the HRTM analysis. So you can see carbon, you can see vanadium, you can see oxygen, so that it can be confirmed vanadium oxide, it is coated on the carbon nanotube. So basically we have used, initially we have tested this one in the liquid cell by using 3 electrode system, and you need potentiostat for this one. So this is the IV characteristics, just like a solar cell. So area under the curve gives the how much charge it is stored by that supercapacitor. So we have done this one for the carbon nanotube. Black color you can see, this is red color for vanadium oxide, and blue color for the combination of the carbon nanotube with the vanadium oxide. And this is the specific capacitance we have calculated by using this formula. And you can see carbon nanotube it gives about 40, vanadium oxide it gives about 60. But whenever there is a combination, the capacitance it is increased up to 150 farad per gram. But this depending upon how much scan rate that you are scanning, means whether discharging or charging it is there at the slower rate or higher rate. So that at the slower rate you can get the capacitance above 1000 faraday per gram, and this is a great achievement it is there in terms of the capacitance. This is very great value, because you can see the capacitor which can have the capacitance in the microfarad or maybe maximum millifarad, but this one it is in the farad, thousands of farad. So this is above 1000 farad per gram, means if you are investing 1 gram you can get the capacitance above 1000 farad at 2 millivolt per second. So not only this one, but here you can see that this is the potential window. This is 1 volt potential window. It is there in the liquid cell. Single electrode if you are using dipping inside the liquid electrolyte. Then stability it is most important. You can see that battery can charge and discharge maybe about 400 to 600 cycle, but supercapacitor it requires higher. So we have tested for example 4000 cycles, and you can see that almost more than 93% it is stable for almost 4000 cycles in the liquid configuration. But with the liquid, as I said, there is a lot of issue, it is there, toxicity it is there, second liquid evaporation it is there, perfect sealing it is required, right? Whenever you are using the supercapacitor in many devices like electronic device, if leakage it is there, liquid it is coming out of the device, not only it can damage the supercapacitor, but your whole device can be damaged. So accident can be there. So to avoid that one, what we have done, instead of using liquid, we have made that device completely solid state. So which can have a long term issue it is there, so that long term stability may be there. So we have used 2 electrode system inside this one. Here you can see that this is a stainless steel, this is carbon nanotube, this is vanadium oxide. Same electrode we have taken here in the symmetric configuration. Symmetric means what? Both the electrodes are same. And here we have used PVA as a dielectric media and lithium perchloride, LiCl4, as a conducting media. So this is the conducting matrix inside the non-conducting media. So it can act as a dielectric as well as the charges are there, so that it can act as a dual purpose. So this is the complete device it is there, and here you can see this is a flexible, so that you can possible to bend, and this is completely solid state. So Initially, this made, we have made the gel of the PVA, LiCO4 inside the aqueous medium. Then we have inserted between these two electrodes. Then we have placed that one for overnight and we have dried that one. So at end, you can have the completely solid state device in your hand. Not only this one, it can be flexible. You can bend that one. How much extent to bend, that also we have tested that one in the laboratory. So here you can see stepwise development, it is there. This is completely solid state device. So for single electrode, we got 1 volt. But we have sandwiched that one in the symmetric volt, we got 2 volt for the device. And here you can see that this is the specific capacitance we observed about 468 farad per gram at 2 millivolt per second. Not only this one, it is having much more better stability than the liquid one. So it is having stability more than 95%. So that it can charge and discharge for 4000 cycle, having the stability about 95%. And that is the greatest advantage of this type of device. Not only this one, we have connected in series and parallel combination to see whether voltage it is increased or not. And here you can see that this is 3.6 volt it is there as the potential window whenever we have connected in a series. Now, this is the charge discharge study, and this is called energy density versus power, called as the Reagan plot. And our material gives the best material amongst the different studied material, having the specific energy 72 watt per kg and 2.3 kilowatt as the specific power, having very less resistance as it is completely solid state device. So here you can see that whether the device is flexible or not. We have just bent that device and we have tested that one, and here we have bent up to 175 degree bending angle, and we observed that it is 90% stable. So you can bend that one up to 175 degree, still it is 90% stable. Not only this one, we have tested continuously for almost 7 days. And here you can see that the stability curve is there. There is no alteration in the CV curve, and the device is very, very stable, more than 95% for almost 7 days, charging, discharging for almost 7 days. So it is having very great stability as well. And not only this, we have the 3x4 cm device, and we have LED panel, VNIT, consisting of 21 red LEDs. So this device gives 1.8 volt, this red LED required 1.6 volt, and we have run this one for almost 6 minutes. So we have charged within less than 1 minute, and we have run almost for more than 5 minutes. These results also published in the Electrochemical Acta as well as the scientific report from the Nature. Here I can show you the demo for this one. This was also published inside the newspapers. This DST invited me. This belongs to the one project for DST Technology Mission Division. Actually, from CIMED, Dr. Kale, he is the director. He was our co-PI, and Dr. Sharma, he was collaborator from the industry, and I was PI for this project. DST invited me, and they have given the booth to demonstrate this one. And VK Saraswati ji, they have visited and they have seen the working device, and we have seen this one to. Shown this one to Professor Ashutosh Sharma, Secretary DST, as well as Professor Ram Gopal Rao, Director IIT, during this booth visit. Here you can see that this is the device which is made in the laboratory, completely solid state, 3x4 cm. This is get charged by using battery, 3 volt. This is simply lab-made device, and at the end you can see simply tixotape it is there. There is no proper sealing, simply because it is completely solid state. This is VNIT panel consisting of 21 red LEDs. And you can see, this is discharged to this VNIT panel. Those having electronic background, they can simulate the result as well for this type of device. Here you can see, this is working very well. Very small device, 3x4 cm. Here you can see that this I demonstrated in the DST meeting. Here you can see this is device get charged through this battery, and there is a small fan, and this is charged within few seconds, 30 to 40 seconds, and here you can see how much it is running. This is the project टेक्नोलॉजी मिशन डिवीजन, so if you stack this type of device in series and parallel combination, it is possible to get more voltage as well, and this is completely solid state. That is the greatest advantage, as well as flexible. So you can think to work on some problem related to this one or maybe any other problem, but you should have basic understanding. But whatever things you are doing, it should be applicable to the society. So these are recent achievements in this area. Paper published more than having 10 impacts or 12 impacts. I wish to acknowledge SLB and DST for the grant. Thank you very much. So, any questions also?
Participants, please gather in communication lab, which is on first floor in Simbili.